There are two roads. There are two ways. The Bible's pretty clear about that. As it says in this morning scripture from the Hebrew Bible, there's a way of life and prosperity and a way of death and adversity. I might as well say it now. When it says prosperity, it doesn't mean you always got cash in your pocket, but trust me, we can look back on some of our poorest times and realize that we were happy and wealthy in ways that mattered. And when it talks about adversity, it's not just economic adversity. There's people in this world who got everything they wanted and are not happy. Then Jesus goes us one better. He says we can make a choice not only between life and death, prosperity and adversity, because he knows his Hebrew Bible too. We can make a choice between life and real life. We can make a choice between life and real life. Well, I don't know what poems we learn. You know, things change. There's so much knowledge for our kids that there just isn't time to stuff it in their heads. And thank heavens they've got Google. We didn't need Google because most of history hadn't happened yet when we were kids, people like me. But one of the things we often did was recite poems, and probably many of you learned the poem by Robert Frost that was originally called The Two Roads, but is now called The Road Less Traveled, which he wrote in 1915. Anyway, Robert Frost was not a well-known poet. He was born in 1874, and in the early 20th century, he moved to London, England, because he just wasn't having much success. He met a man named Edward Thomas, who was a frustrated writer. That is, he was a very successful writer, but he was writing book reviews and essays and journalism and the kind of things that I do and I'm perfectly happy with. But he wanted to be a poet. He wanted to be remembered. And he didn't feel like he could move away from the writing that paid good money to the writing that mattered. War broke out in 1914. England and Europe were plunged into the Great War, which everybody thought would last a couple months, but went on for four extraordinarily brutal years, to the point where we're not even sure how many died, between 20 and 40 million, and it may have been more. Whole generations of youth were wiped out. But early on, there was no draft. It was a choice. Did you want to go and defend your country? And Edward Thomas had finally, at the encouragement of Robert Frost, turned to writing the poetry that he loved and had a couple of books published of poetry, which had received some good notice. But he wondered, should I go to war? And Robert Frost wrote him a poem which he thought would explain pretty clearly that the choice didn't matter that much. Don't sweat it. Two roads diverged in a yellow wood, and sorry that I could not travel both and be one traveler. Long I stood and looked down one as far as I could to where it bent in the undergrowth. I then took the other, and as just as fair and having perhaps the better claim because it was grassy and wanted wear. Though as for that, the passing there had warned them really about the same. And both that morning equally lay in leaves, no step had trodden black. Oh, I kept the first for another day. Yet knowing how way leads on to way, I doubted if I should ever come back. Well, Frost knew his friend was uncertain what to do in the face of the Great War, and so the poem was supposed to mean, maybe you're overthinking things. Maybe the choice is not as momentous as you think. And then in the last paragraph, perhaps the most famous, the last stanza, Frost says, I shall be telling this with a sigh. Somewhere ages and ages hence, two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by, and that has made all the difference. Well, Edward Thomas took the poem totally differently. He understood this to say, you have to make the choice. You could make the choice to go less traveled, those who turn away from war, and those who follow the great crowd who who were signing up for the war that was only going to last a few months, the war to end all wars. Edward Thomas immediately signed up, went through training, and within a couple weeks was dead. One of the millions whose lives were lost, a whole generation of young people in England, France, and Germany who were the missing generation. Maybe Frost should have known. People agonize over choices and want any sort of light to decide, how should I choose? What matters? And are the choices really clear? And what will be the consequences? For some of us, we may think, well, I've already made my choices. I don't have any more choices to make. Some of us may be thinking, all my choices lie ahead, and I don't see clearly what's ahead of me. We want to have, I think, almost a little time machine or a time machine viewer so we can know what it is we're supposed to be doing. We want to know if the possibility of choices is past, if the die is cast now, and there's no more choices to be made. Well, here is Moses in his farewell address to the people, having discussed many subjects. I just love this sentence. See. It's imperative. I have said it many different ways, so now I'm just going to say it as clearly as I can. I have set before your face this day. Now, you know how everybody knows some Hebrew and they don't know it. You already know L'chaim because you get to sing that song in Fiddler on the Roof. To life, L'chaim. I've set before you L'chaim and Hatov. I have sent before you life and goodness, prosperity, richness, and death. And not just death, but adversity and failure. Remember what I said earlier. Failure is not necessarily tied up with how much cash is in our pocket, whether we've crossed off everything on our bucket list, or whether life has gone exactly as we planned. The real question is whether we've taken life as it has come to us and lived richly with our loved ones and our friends, done our best to undo our mistakes, and have gladly accepted the forgiveness offered to us. I thought the children, this story this morning, couldn't have put it more plainly. And my only regret is I didn't get up earlier and bump Rex so I'd get the free lunch. Good story. That was great. And then in this passage, the thing is, almost like here's the answer, so you know. There are 8 references to choosing life and only 3 to death, because you should get it. You should understand. And more important at the end, what it means is, the length of your days, you will have life and long length of days, is not so much about my life. It's saying, when you make the good choices, when you make the good choices, it's not just about us, it's about our children and grandchildren. And if we don't have children, it's about the people that come after us. And if we're touching the land, it's about who's going to have the land after we're gone and what shape we're going to leave it for them. And when we talk about the world and the environment, what will 3 generations, 4 generations, 5 generations receive from us? Something better or something worse? It's about the chronological length of the blessing when we choose the right thing. Now, there's only one thing missing from this passage. Satan. Nothing about temptation. It's not like the thing where we always see the little angel and the little devil on our shoulders. You know, when you look at cartoons or TV shows, I often think my dog Duncan, you know, who is the one who not only can think about taking food off the counter, he can actually get up to the counter. And I know he's got a little devil dog that's saying, go ahead, take the dumb guy's breakfast. He's got a little angel dog over here saying, yeah, let's get it. He may not have the ability to make as many choices as I do, but the point is, in that passage in Deuteronomy and this passage here today, You know, Jesus knows about Satan, and he even argues with him during the temptation, his own temptation. But in these passages, it's really saying, stop blaming somebody else. Brush him off your shoulder and start making the choices. Jesus is quoting from the Hebrew scriptures, and he's saying, we can do even better than just choosing life. You have heard that you should not be angry, you should not murder. But I tell you, don't just murder. You know, you're under judgment if you get angry. It says here, if you say about your brother or sister, raka, which is an Aramaic word, it's not Greek. And it's kind of like what you say around the family table. Oh, come on, you big idiot. You know how you're always criticizing somebody and wearing them down so they start to think maybe I am? My father, who I look up to and admire, you know, bless his heart and glad he's looking down on us from heaven. But he didn't ever use harsh language about other people at our table. There was only one thing he'd ever say. Once in a while, when he'd hear about somebody really doing something really dumb, he'd mutter under his breath, Tonto Juan. Tonto Juan, dumb John. That's as bad as it got, you know. And not directed at us either, just people that are just, they ought to know better. Tonto Juan, raca. But it says here, if you say that, if you're making yourself bigger by insulting others, if you cannot be content with who you are, but you have to be better than everybody else all the time, you will end up in the fires of, and it's not hell, it's Gehenna. Gehenna is the trash heap, which is burning. Gehenna is where you throw your papers, and it's no more. I think in Indiana it's where you throw your leaves, but nobody else does it but you guys. But they're no more. In other words, it's not even hell. It's not even eternity. You're not worth it. If all you can do is make yourself big by putting others down, then you're no more. You're not worth thinking about anymore. You're not part of God's plans anymore. Gehenna. Then we get to the teaching about adultery. You know, those of us who went to the spa fundraiser last night, as always, very inspiring. And some of you have had some of the ladies from spa be in your Sunday school classes, the women who are recovering from addictive behaviors. Well, this scripture is about treating people, especially women, as objects, where he says, don't waste your time worrying about renting a motel room. As soon as you start thinking about people, as soon as you start thinking about people of the other sex as objects, you've already made yourself nothing. I guarantee, bless their hearts, every one of those women was treated as an object by somebody. You can hear it in their stories. You can see the damage we do when we start identifying people solely by their political party or by their height or their weight, or by their gender, or by the car they drive, or which country they come from. When we start placing borders between people, we have made them into objects. We don't need to put Satan into that equation. We're perfectly capable of reducing people to nothing. And then there's the teaching about divorce, which people get all bent out of shape about. Well, that means you can't have divorce. No, what it means is that in those days, men could get rid of women anytime they wanted, and women were powerless to do anything about it. And Jesus was trying to level the playing field. You don't get to just divorce. You men don't just get to divorce a woman anytime you feel like it, is what Jesus was saying. And once again, people are not throwaways. Our relationships are not throwaways. He's asking us to instead remember that each person is a rich treasure created by God in God's image, irreplaceable. There's a wonderful sentence in C.S. Lewis's essay, The Weight of Glory. You have never met a mere mortal. You have never met a mere mortal. And finally, the teaching about oaths, making your yes, yes, and your no, no. You know, those of us who are parents have probably been a co-signer at one time or another. And when we were younger, we might have had somebody be a co-signer with us on a loan. Maybe we didn't quite have enough credit at one point in our lives, so somebody else's credit had to stand up for ours. Well, when you do that, when somebody's a co-signer, that means that if we mess up and don't pay off the loan, they have to. And Jesus is saying, every time you bring God into it, every time you say, oh, swear to God, just throwing God's name around. I swear by God. Or even, maybe you're not going to say by that, you're going to say, oh, I swear upon so-and-so's life. I swear upon every hair of my head. Jesus reminds us, you can't make one thing. You know, now, he did live in an age when people couldn't make white hair black again. And we don't. But that's not the point. Doesn't matter how much hair conditioner you put on. We can't change the basic fact about life that time is moving on a minute at a time. And we can't turn it backwards. So he says, don't bring God into your mess. Don't make God a co-signer for your mistakes. Start making your own choices. Building up your own credit or creating your own debt in terms of the lives we share with each other. Because it is a life and death choice. And more than that, it's a life and more life choice. It's a life and better life choice. It's a life and real life choice. That's the choice. You want to be content with just getting by? I said the right words and now I'm saved. I'm going to sit down and just try to wait this out. That's the salvation that many people offer. Or are you going to make this life worth living? So when you get that crown of glory, you can put it on your head and say, hey, I look pretty good in this thing if I do myself, before you cast it out and say, I owe it all to God. There's nothing wrong with making mistakes. And there's nothing wrong with admitting it. And there's nothing wrong with seeking to make amends. We're going to fail. We won't always measure up. But it's important. And those are the choices that are being offered here today. Life and prosperity, regardless of whether we got two nickels to rub together. Death and adversity, whether I am the richest person in the world, I discover I can't buy happiness. Yeah, two roads converge. Whether you take the one more traveled or less traveled, in the end, the real choice is whether you'll choose life or even more life. Amen.